Hi, guys. Thanks so much for coming out to watch this episode. This is the third and the last update on the coronavirus. I will focus on four common medications you can find in your medicine cabinet and the research behind them. A couple weeks back, I talked about how important a patient advocate is today. These three episodes on the coronavirus update, especially this episode, are based on the need for a patient advocate. One of the responsibilities of a patient advocate is to help you identify the medical research and options, enabling you to have a more informed conversation with your medical providers. So in part one, the episode reviewed how the virus acts and some of the scientific speculation on why the virus was acting in these ways. And maybe in the next couple months, as more information becomes available, science is going to be able to put together more context around two of the issues covered in that episode, which is viral loads and mortality. In part two, the science of the impact of Candida auris and the flu were reviewed. In part three, this episode, the focus is going to be on four medications that could be in your medicine cabinet to help reduce the symptoms and severity of COVID-19. You know, there are many treatments I could have focused on, but none of them could help you as much as what you can do at home. And that's because you and I are just ordinary people, which means you don't get tested every day. More likely, you're actually going to be sick before even thinking about getting tested. And the whole testing process is not easy. It takes time. I just did a quick rundown of what it would take if I wanted to get tested. Where I live, there are 12 testing locations in an area of 3,500 square miles. I have to schedule an appointment, which takes 1 to 2 days, and the results take 1 to 3 days. They say there are free facilities, but when I actually went in to book an appointment at the free facility, the location wasn't accepting appointments. It was that kind of reality, and knowing that the only way I could get admitted to a hospital was if I was really sick, that had me looking at what was available in Western medicine. And, you know, I do Chinese medicine, and China had already shown good results with a few of their herbal formulas. So I would have been comfortable with these formulas, except the crucial herb needed in these formulas is not available. And I'm assuming it's because China isn't exporting it, but I don't know. So I'm going to focus on four medications. Two of them are over the counter, and two are by prescription. So let's hit it. The first two are going to be the over-the-counter medications. These are meds you can get at the grocery store, at Walgreens and Target. You can get these without a prescription. And, you know, what was identified in one of the research studies is the potential benefits to those with COVID-19 infection include possible faster healing, the ability to take a low-risk, inexpensive, well-known, and commonly used medication with a long safety history, and possible reduction of potential complications of COVID infections. That means these first two over-the-counter medications are well-known, commonly used, and inexpensive. So the first one is going to be Pepcid AC, and we saw that it was the one medication given to the president when he contracted COVID. So Pepcid AC is an over-the-counter heartburn medicine. What originally flagged this drug were reports coming out of China. China found that people who took famotidine, the drug in Pepcid AC, were surviving COVID-19, but they also noticed that people who had the same risk factors but were taking a different heartburn medication like cimetidine in Tagamet or omeprazole in Prilosec, they were not surviving the disease. So it's the active ingredient in Pepcid AC, famotidine, that appears to have an effect on the virus. Now, I want you to remember that Pepcid AC belongs to the drug class of H2 blockers because that's going to be important when we look at the next over-the-counter medication. And if you're wondering what H2 blockers are, I'll put a link to my program on ways to keep your memory sharp and crush your final season in the video description below. Let's look at the research. So testing of famotidine, it began in April. Hospitalized patients were given intravenous famotidine. And as you can probably guess, they did better with this. But you and I are at home. Guess what? We don't have access to intravenous famotidine. So let's look at the studies in May and June. The June study, it was a small study of outpatients who took famotidine, and it was reported their symptoms, such as a cough, shortness of breath, improved within a day or two of taking the heartburn drug. Yay! There's a great article in Chemical and Engineering News called "Can Pepcid Treat COVID-19, and that is from June of this year. It gives a great unbiased review of what was happening to date on Pepcid AC. There's a link to that article in the video description below. In August, there's another study on the use of famotidine with people in the hospital. And here's the great part about this study. This famotidine group, the majority of them were taking oral famotidine, just like we would use it at home. Here's where we start to get the skinny on dose and use. The most common dose, 20 milligrams, 2 pills of Pepcid AC original a day. And the rest of the oral was 40 milligrams or 4 pills of Pepcid AC original. Okay, what about the guys taking it intravenously? How much were they taking? They were only taking 20 milligrams or 2 pills of Pepcid AC a day. Hey, and what were the results? Pretty amazing, a 45% reduction in in-hospital mortality. They had a 48% less likely need of breathing assistance, and three key inflammation markers consistently lower results. All the information can be found in links in the video description below. So hey, check it out. Okay, that's the skinny on Pepcid AC. Sounds like something you might want to have in your medicine cabinet, huh? The next over-the-counter drug is Zyrtex, and Zyrtex is a brand name. The active ingredient in Zyrtex is cetirizine, and Zyrtex, or cetirizine, is another over-the-counter second-generation antihistamine used for allergies. So COVID-19 can cause critical lung damage that can lead to death. There's some medical history that the combination of H1 and H2 blockers can be effective in certain inflammatory issues. So remember, Pepcid AC is an H2 blocker. Well, Zyrtex is an H1 blocker. And if you're wondering what H1 blockers are, I'll put a link to my program on ways to keep your memory sharp and crush your final season in the video description below. There was a physician-sponsored study in August of 2020 using a combination of Zyrtex or cetirizine and Pepcid AC or famotidine in patients with severe and critical lung problems. So Zyrtex was given at 10 milligrams a day, twice a day, and famotidine was given at 20 milligrams 2 times a day. You know, once again, the results were really positive. There was like a 25 to 40% reduction in-hospital deaths. And the time it took for you to get out of the hospital was reduced by about 40%. The physician who led this study is doing another research study with people who've tested positive for COVID, and they are outpatients, so they're not in the hospital. And the goal of the study is preventing the progression of the disease and keeping people out of the hospital. There's a link to this research study in the video description below, but I want to take a minute to look at this research study because I think this guy's like really amazing. So thank you so much, Dr. Hogan. Okay, so here is the link to the study, and they give you a brief description of the study, what you can expect, what you're going to go through. And then they go through the study medications, what they're going to do. And here it is. The cetirizine is 10 milligrams. The famotidine is 20 milligrams, 2 times a day, up to 21 days. And they're going to provide the medications. Then they also identify who shouldn't do this. What's the exclusion criteria? Well, if you have an allergy to one of these drugs, if you have serious drug interactions, here's another one, patients who drink alcohol daily, more than 3 drinks for males and 2 drinks for females. So this gives you some of the criteria that's going to exclude you from the study. Okay, really excited to see what the results of that research study are going to be. And again, thank you so much, Dr. Hogan, for your information and persistence. Okay, wow, we are almost at the 11-minute mark. So I want to quickly touch base on the next two, and I'm going to do both of them together and put the research links in the video description below to hopefully make this go faster. First one, Celebrex. It's a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory, and it's used for pain management. Celebrex, pretty much prescribed for any type of arthritis pain. And I'm going to put a link to the drug warnings in the description below. Just an FYI, it can cause heart attack or stroke, and I guess it can do it without any warning. Okay, so the research indicates it appears to hinder the prostaglandin inflammatory response in the body. And okay, so that means pretty much nothing to all of us, but prostaglandins can cause inflammation in the body. And how they measure it is through the urine. The researchers think this prostaglandin E2 may be a critical factor in COVID-19 inflammation. And what they found is that this prostaglandin E2 is materially elevated in patients diagnosed with COVID-19. And they found that the higher the level, the more severe the infection. Okay, the research study that I was looking at used Celebrex at 200 milligrams one or two times a day for a period of 7 to 14 days. And here's the results. Those that were taking the 200 milligrams two times a day experienced 100% remission at the end of the treatment. Those that were taking the 200 milligrams one time a day, 82% of them experienced remission, but 18% of them experienced a rebound in symptoms. In the control group, only 25% experienced remission, and 75% rebounded. Now, here's the thing with the rebound on both of those. The rebound, I guess, comes back really quick, and it's much more severe. So what they were saying in the study is that they think that you have to really think about how long you're taking Celebrex. The study was a quick read. It's pretty interesting. So maybe check it out in the link in the video description below. Last medication. It's another prescription medication, and it is albuterol. This is an inhaler. It stops bronchial spasms in the lung. The one thing they suggested about using these inhalers is use them outside. Using them inside, it sounds like it has a similar effect to sneezing, and it disperses these droplets throughout. So the scientists suggest use these inhalers outside so to minimize the potential to spread the virus. Okay, there you have it, 4 of them. 2 of them are over the counter, and there seems to be some pretty cool research on them. Besides that, make sure you have Gatorade or Pedialyte, your favorite blanket, and your TV. Okay, thanks guys for stopping by. Until next time, I'll catch you on the other side. And hey, stay safe out there.